Welcome to the Light of the Nations Gospel Program. Thank you for allowing us to come week after week into your homes to be able to share the Word of God with all of you. Thank you for your responses, and we continue to covet your prayers and your support so that this program will be a blessing to many, many around the world. For the last several weeks, we have been talking about the different disciplines that are essential in a Christian's life. We talked about prayer, and we talked about prayer extensively. We talked about how to use scripture for praying. We talked about how to have the discipline of witnessing daily for the Lord Jesus Christ. I know that my husband, Dr. George Palil, was here with us for a couple of weeks to share and to witness about his life testimony. And we have made some pre-recordings also that will be played in our absence when we are going to be gone on a mission trip for several weeks. So please continue to uphold us in your prayer. Today, I would like to continue to speak on the daily discipline of witnessing for the Lord Jesus Christ through the spoken word. You know, our words which we speak are very powerful, and God has given us the faculty of speech and the tongue so that it can be used to spread the good news. And we're going to look at some biblical examples of people who were instrumental in practicing this wonderful discipline of witnessing to the Lord through the spoken word. And we have no better example in scripture than in the person of John the Baptist. We will see how he witnessed through the spoken word. So I would like for you to go with me to the prophecy of Isaiah chapter 40, and I will read from verses 3 to 8. This is concerning John the Baptist. The voice of him that crieth in the wilderness, prepare ye the way of the Lord, make straight in the desert the highway for our God. Every valley shall be exalted, and every mountain and hill shall be made low, and the crooked shall be made straight, and the rough places plain. And the glory of the Lord shall be revealed, and all flesh shall see his glory together, for the mouth of the Lord hath spoken it. The voice said, cry, and he said, what shall I cry? All flesh is as grass, and all the goodliness thereof is as the flower of the field. The grass withereth, the flower fadeth, because the Spirit of the Lord bloweth upon it. Surely the people is grass. The grass withereth, the flower fadeth, but the word of our God shall stand forever. Isaiah chapter 40, verses 3 to 8. So in Isaiah chapter 40, John the Baptist is the prophet is announcing the coming of the forerunner, the one who comes before the Messiah, announcing the coming of the Messiah, the anointed one, the Christos, our Lord and Savior. He is the forerunner that comes to announce the promised one, the Messiah. He was just a voice. Can you imagine the post and the position that is given to this great man of God? He is just referred to as a voice. It is so humbling, but at the same time, such an honor to be even just a voice in the wilderness, so to say, for our Lord and our Savior. When we come to the Gospel of John now, John's Gospel chapter 1, and we'll read a few verses from there that will actually help us understand this message. So John's Gospel chapter 1, and beginning at verse 1, in the beginning was the Word, and the Word was with God, and the Word was God. The same was in the beginning with God. All things were made by him, and without him was not anything made that was made. Verse 4, in him was life, and the life was the light of men. And the light shineth in the darkness, and the darkness comprehended it not. Verse 6, there was a man sent from God whose name was John. The same came for a witness to bear witness of the light, that all men through him might believe. He was not that light, but he was sent to bear witness of that light. That was the true light which lighteth every man that cometh into the world. So I read to you from John's Gospel, chapter 1, verses 1 through 9, that John the Baptist was sent to this world to be like a voice crying in the wilderness, announcing the coming, announcing the coming of the Messiah, and he was to be a witness to the Messiah. And indeed, that is what he did, and that is what his life was all about. Then we see that in verses 19 through 27, John has quite an audience, and they had questions about who he was, and they probed into who he was. They wanted demanded all these answers to these questions that they had about John the Baptist. And so we read from verses 19 all the way through 27 first. And this is the record of John when the Jews sent priests and Levites from Jerusalem to ask him, "Who art thou?" And he confessed and denied not, but confessed, "I am not the Christ." He witnessed, "I'm not the Christ." And they asked him, "What then? Art thou Elias?" And he said, "I'm not. Art thou that prophet?" And he answered, "No." Then said they unto him, "Who art thou that we may give an answer to them that sent us? What sayest thou of thyself? Speak up and let us know who you are." Because the prophet Isaiah referred to him as a voice. And here the apostle John is writing and saying he was just a witness. He was not the light. He just came to bear witness of the true light. Verse 22, then said they unto him, "Who art thou that we may give an answer to them that sent us? What sayest thou of thyself?" Look at John's testimony about himself, John the Baptist. He said, "I am the voice of one crying in the wilderness, 'Make straight the way of the Lord,' as said the prophet Isaiah." And they which were sent were of the Pharisees, and they asked him and said unto him, "Why baptizest thou then, if thou be not that Christ, nor Elias, neither that prophet?" John answered and saying, "I baptize with water, but there standeth one among you whom you know not. He it is who coming after me is preferred before me, whose shoes latchet I am not worthy to unloose. These things were done in Bethabara beyond Jordan, before which John was baptizing." So we see that he witnesses and he says, "Listen, I am not the Messiah. I am not the anointed one. I am not the promised one. I am just a voice." Like the prophet Isaiah said, "I have come just to," of course he didn't say that, but the apostle John writes about him and says he came to be a witness to the coming Messiah. Then what did he do? He lived true to his calling. He did not want anything else. He didn't want place. He didn't want position. He did not want to be acknowledged. He didn't want honor. None of that stuff. He just lived up to his calling of being a voice, speaking, pointing, and showing the people the promised Messiah. We read now from verses 29 to 36 of John's Gospel, chapter 1. The next day, John seeth Jesus coming unto him and said, "Behold, the Lamb of God, which taketh away the sin of the world." Now he's opening his mouth and he's confessing and he's pointing out to Jesus. And he opens his mouth and he witnesses with the spoken words, "Behold, this is the Lamb of God that takes away the sin of the world." "This is he of whom I said, 'After me cometh a man which is preferred before me, for he was before me.'" John is confessing, "This Son of God, this Messiah, this anointed one is the eternal one. I have just come in time to be a voice to announce and to point him out to the people in this day and age. And I knew him not, but that he should be manifest to Israel. Therefore am I come baptizing with water. And John bare record saying, I saw the Spirit descending from heaven like a dove, and it abode on him. John goes on to further witness through the spoken word that he saw with his eyes the Spirit of God descending on him at the time of his baptism. And I knew him not, but he that sent me to baptize with water, the same said unto me, upon whom thou shalt see the Spirit descending and remaining on him, the same is he which baptizeth with the Holy Ghost. So John was a humble man. He didn't want to take any extra credit. And when he was asked, why are you baptizing if you're not the Messiah, if you're not Elijah, if you're not any great prophet, then why are you baptizing? He said, listen, I'm just baptizing with water, but there is one standing among you whose shoelaces I'm not worthy to unloose or tie. He will baptize you with the Holy Ghost and with fire. In other words, meaning only the anointed one, only Jesus, Son of God, has the power and the authority and the ability to baptize us with the Holy Ghost and with fire. Not even John has that awesome privilege. Verse 34, and I saw and bear record that this is the Son of God. Again, the next day after John stood and two of his disciples, and looking upon Jesus as he walked, he said, behold, the Lamb of God, opening his mouth and witnessing to the promised Messiah's person and to the promised Messiah's ministry. Praise the Lord. Well, we will look yet at another gospel writer's account, and for that we will go to the Gospel of Matthew, chapter 3, and we will read what this gospel writer has to say about this voice in the wilderness, this John the Baptist, who witnessed to the Savior, who witnessed to the Messiah through his spoken words. Not just through his spoken words, but he also was a witness through his life and through his commitment. We'll find that out in a little bit. So Matthew's Gospel, chapter 3, we will read verses 1 through 3, 4 first. In those days came John the Baptist preaching in the wilderness of Judea and saying, repent ye, for the kingdom of heaven is at hand. What was he witnessing? He was witnessing and telling them that they are sinners and that they need to be saved and they need to repent because the kingdom of heaven is at hand. In other words, the Messiah is just going to surface and you have to repent from your evil ways to that wicked and evil generation and time and people. John was a witness. He opened his mouth and he said, repent and be baptized, for the kingdom of heaven is at hand. For this is he that was spoken of by the prophet Isaiah, saying, the voice of one crying in the wilderness, prepare ye the way of the Lord, make his paths straight. And the same John had his raiment of camel's hair and a leathern girdle about his loins, and his meat was locust and wild honey. Rings a bell. When you go to the Old Testament and you read about the prophet Elijah, you will see that there are many parallels and many similarities between John the Baptist and the prophet Elijah. For one thing, both of them had the anointing and the power and the indwelling presence of the Holy Spirit. Both of them were rugged men. Both of them were prophets. Both of them were committed to God. Both of them were fearless because of the boldness that was there in them through the presence of the Holy Spirit. Both of them were blunt. Both of them had no fear. And both of them said what they had to say, no matter to whom it was. So now we go to verse 5. You see, his very presence was a witness. John the Baptist's very presence was a witness. The Pharisees and the Jews were very familiar with Elijah. Elijah and Elijah were great prophets of the Hebrew people. And they knew about his rugged appearance, and they knew about his boldness, and they knew about the anointing and the power that was upon Elijah and his lifestyle. And so when they see John the Baptist, they see a lot of parallel between the two. And so his his manner of life, his lifestyle, his manner of life, his ministry, all of this also was a witness to the power and to the truth of the gospel. Then we look at verse 5, then went out to him Jerusalem and all Judea and all the region round about Jordan, and were baptized of him in Jordan, confessing their sins. Verse 7, but when he saw many of the Pharisees and Sadducees come to his baptism, he said unto them, O generation of vipers, who hath warned you to flee from the wrath to come? He is witnessing with his mouth. You are equivalent to vipers because you are full of poison. Your hearts are not clean. Your minds are not clean. You need to get rid of all this poison that is in you. You need to repent and be baptized. He compares them to vipers. Bring forth therefore fruits meant for repentance. He's witnessing and he's calling the people to repentance. And think not to say within yourself, we have Abraham to our father. Forget about all your tradition. Your tradition is not going to save you. Abraham's righteousness will not be yours unless and until you repent and you get right with God. You have Abraham to our father. For I say unto you that God is able of these stones to raise up children unto Abraham. Verse 10. And now look, also the axe is laid unto the root of the trees. Therefore, every tree that bringeth forth not good fruit is hewn down and cast into the fire. I indeed baptize you with water unto repentance, but he that cometh after me is mightier than I, whose shoes latcheth I am not worthy to bear. He shall baptize you with the Holy Ghost and with power. John the Baptist is telling the crowds and telling the people of his time, you need the baptism in the Holy Spirit. Why? Because the Holy Spirit has power to cleanse us and sanctify us and set us on the right track. He keeps us holy and he prepares us for the Lord's second coming. Whose fan is in his hand, and he will thoroughly purge his floor and gather his wheat into the garner. But he will burn up the chaff with unquenchable fire. Then cometh Jesus from Galilee to Jordan and to John to be baptized of him. But John forbade him, saying, I have need to be baptized of thee, and comest thou to me? And Jesus answering said unto him, suffer it to be so now, for thus it becometh us to fulfill all righteousness. Then he suffered. And verse 16, and Jesus, when he was baptized, went up straightway out of the water. And lo, the heavens were opened unto him, and he saw the Spirit of God descending like a dove and lighting upon him. And lo, a voice from heaven saying, this is my beloved Son, in whom I am well pleased. This is what John the Apostle was writing about when he says that about Jesus, that when he saw the dove, he had seen with his eyes the dove descending and sitting upon Jesus, verifying that indeed he is the Son of God and he is the promised Messiah. John the Baptist, his very presence was a witness to the power of God and to the works of God. And we also know that he witnessed through the spoken word. And Matthew chapter 14, verses 1 through 14, there is the account of John the Baptist, this righteous, bold, and holy man. His head is chopped off, and it is asked to be brought forth in a silver platter. Let me read quickly to you. Matthew chapter 14, verses 1 through 14. At that time, Herod the tetrarch heard of the fame of Jesus, and said unto his servant, this is John the Baptist, he is risen from the dead, and therefore mighty works do show forth themselves in him. You see, Herod was under guilt, and he was afraid when he heard about the miracles and the authority with which Jesus taught, and the crowds and the multitudes that believed in Jesus and that followed the Lord. And so when Jesus came to the forefront in his fulfilling his mission and his calling and his ministry, then Herod feared within his heart and mind and thought that this is John the Baptist risen from the dead. Verse 3, for Herod had laid hold of John and bound him and put him in prison for Herodias' sake, his brother Philip's wife. You see, Herod the king had an illicit affair with his brother's wife. And John the Baptist openly condemned it. And as a result of that, of course, Herodias was looking for an opportune moment. And when she got the time and the moment, she asked for John the Baptist's head to be bought in a silver platter. Verse 4. For John said unto him, it is not lawful for thee to have her. And when he would have put him to death, who? Herod. He feared the multitude because they counted him as a prophet. He was a righteous man, a holy man. But when Herod's birthday was kept, the daughter of Herodias danced before them and pleased Herod. Whereupon he promised with an oath to give her whatsoever she would ask. And she, being before instructed of her mother, said, give me here John the Baptist's head in a charger. And the king was sorry, nevertheless, for the oath's sake, and them which sat with him at meat, he commanded it to be given her. And he sent and beheaded John in the prison. And his head was brought in a charger and given to the damsel, and she brought it to her mother. And his disciples came and took up the body and buried it and went and told Jesus. When Jesus heard of it, he departed thence by ship into a desert place. And when the people had heard thereof, they followed him on foot out of the city. So you see, here was a man who witnessed to the Lord, not just through the spoken word, but his very life. And of course, in the end, he was martyred because of his commitment and because of the words that he spoke with boldness, because of the anointing of the Holy Spirit that was upon him. We too have been baptized in the Holy Spirit by the grace of God. And God does not want us to stay still and to stay quiet, but he wants us to be spoken witnesses. He wants us to share the spoken word, because there's power in the word of God. Because John, the Apostle Paul, he writes in the book of Romans chapter 10, faith cometh by hearing and hearing by the word of God. If we don't share the word, if we don't call people to repentance, if we don't point out their sin, nobody will. It's your responsibility. It's my responsibility as the church of Jesus Christ, us who have been set free from the powers of darkness, us who have been brought into his marvelous light. God has given us this command. God has given us this responsibility to be a voice for him in this wicked and evil generation and time. Even as John the Baptist was a voice in the wilderness. He did not fear the Pharisees. He did not fear the religious leaders. He didn't even fear the king. But he spoke the truth and he pointed out his sin. And therefore it cost him his head. Friends, Jesus tells us very clearly in the Gospel of Matthew chapter 10. He says, don't worry about him who has power to destroy your body. It says here, let me read for you. Matthew's Gospel chapter 10 verse 28 and fear not them which kill the body, but are not able to kill the soul, but rather fear him which is able to destroy both body and soul in hell. John the Baptist had no fear. He didn't fear his life. He could care less. He wanted to be a true witness of the Lord Jesus Christ, a true witness of his Father in heaven. It cost him his life. It may cost you your life. It may cost me my life. Doesn't matter what it costs us. God still wants us to lay our lives down for him as witnesses. May the Lord strengthen us and may he enable us to be his witnesses. With our presence, we are the epistles that are read of all men through the spoken word. And if he calls us to give our lives over for him, so be it. That God be glorified, because we will not be losers. Let's pray. Father, we thank you that you have called us at such an age and time to be your witnesses. We pray that you will give us holy boldness that comes from the Holy Spirit to speak up for you, not to be afraid, for you have not given us the spirit of fear, but of power, of love, and of a sound mind. Thank you for the opportunity. May the hearers be blessed in Jesus' name. Amen and amen.